KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's 2 p.m. Stay tuned for About Health with Nurse Rona.
Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. If you're a woman in your 40s or 50s, you may have already experienced symptoms such as hot flashes, insomnia, depression, breast pain, and mood swings. And if you're a man who lives with or works with a woman in that age range, then you've probably been impacted by the symptoms you observe in the women in your life. Today's topic is menopause, and my guests will be giving you information about what to expect, when it actually begins, the treatment options, and we really look forward to taking your calls and answering your questions. And as always, I love hearing about your experience and the advice you may have for others. I'm Nurse Rona. It's been great being your host a few times a month. I've been a radio show host now for over 13 years, and I'm really grateful that KPFA still has live call-in shows and that Dr. Lenore has asked me to help him host About Health. I'll give out the phone number so after I introduce our guests, we can start to take calls and you can get on the air early. The number is 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425 or toll free at 1-800-958-9008. And if you miss any part of the show, it will be archived at kpfa.org or on my website at nurserona.com. I have two great health professionals joining me today. In studio is Barb Dean, a woman's health nurse practitioner in Silicon Valley. She's an award-winning author, a nationally recognized health expert, and a popular speaker on all aspects of women's health. She lectures at Stanford and is a frequent health expert on television and radio throughout the country. Her recent book is The Hot Guide to a Cool, Sexy Menopause. Barb Dean, welcome to About Health.
Oh, Nurse Rona, I'm so excited to be here.
Yeah, it's been a while. We used to do shows together back in the day, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're a lot of fun.
And joining us by phone is Dr. Amy Day. She's a naturopathic doctor in private practice in Berkeley. After 8 years at San Francisco Natural Medicine, Dr. Amy opened her practice specializing in helping busy professional women with stress, fatigue, and hormonal issues. She uses an integrated approach combining diet, exercise, lifestyle, counseling, stress management, nutritional supplements, botanical medicines, and bioidentical hormones. Dr. Amy Day, welcome to KPFA.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm delighted.
Great. Well, we're going to start off with Barb Dean here. She wrote this book, The Hot Guide to Sexy Menopause. Why that title, Barb?
Well, Rona, no woman wants to feel like her best days are behind her. And I think at midlife, so many of us are reaching our prime. We're called primetime women for a reason, because we feel more empowered. Oftentimes our children, if we've had children, they're growing up and growing out. And we want to feel like we are still hot and we are still sexy and that we can do whatever we want.
Yeah, I was just thinking this morning, my daughter, I was, when I was going through menopause, I had a preteen. So she was going through puberty and I was going through menopause. I was thinking back to that. I don't remember a lot. Maybe that's why. I don't know. But yeah, because it's a great time. I'm in my 60s and I feel like, you know, life is really full. I want to know from you what some of the top questions are that women come to see you about regarding menopause.
Well, a lot of times they come in because of three reasons. One is weight gain, the other is sleep, and then sex. And not necessarily in that order. And there's a lot of issues that come up now, you know, the hot flashes and the night sweats. We used to think were the number one issue for women, but when we started really listening to them, it was the sleep and the weight gain and then wanting to stay connected to a partner. That was also important.
Yeah, so those are the things I think we'll try and address for sure. Let me ask Dr. Amy Day first if she can tell us a little bit about perimenopause, because I think this is an important piece for everyone to understand that, you know, menopause is when you no longer have a menstrual period, when you haven't had one for, I guess, about a year. So there's this whole period before then that so many changes are happening. So, Dr. Amy, tell us about how perimenopause impacts women and how that transition into menopause happens.
Sure. So, yeah, it's a really important time in a woman's life, and it's often there are all these changes going on that we don't even connect with the idea of menopause because we're like, oh, I'm in my early 40s, and it doesn't register until things get maybe worse and it's, you know, overt menopausal symptoms. But there is about a 10-year or so time frame prior to that last menstrual period where things are changing, and that can be more dramatic for some women than it is for others. For sure, but it's just a really important time to start getting serious about self-care and about looking to find balance in your life, which is challenging when it's a time that often, like we're talking about having kids or their career advances going on or whatever, but it is an important time to get a foundation in place for health to help through the transitions that are ahead and to really feel empowered going into those changes rather than feeling out of control and suddenly you're living in this body that doesn't feel like it's yours anymore. And a lot of women get worried that it's all downhill from here, and it just doesn't have to be that way. And it's a really beautiful time in life to come to yourself and your self-care and learning to have a partnership with your body to maintain that balance and have great health for 40s, 50s, and many decades beyond.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you for that. And Barb Dean, I would imagine a lot of people come talk to you and they don't even realize that that's what's going on, that they're in perimenopause. Is that right?
Absolutely. And I like what Dr. Amy is talking about, that it's a perfect time for self-care. And perimenopause, a lot of women will start to notice irregularity in periods or really heavy periods or periods from hell or skipping periods. Or they may notice that suddenly they need lubrication or that just, you know, once in a while in the middle of the night they feel a little warmth in the back of their neck. So all those are early signs.
Yeah. Well, let's take calls. We want to hear what you've done to help, what your questions are. 848-4425 or 1-800-958-9008. We have a call now. We have Teresa with us. Good afternoon, Teresa.
Good afternoon.
Hi.
Thank you so much for bringing up the subject of menopause.
You're welcome.
The unspoken conversation, and in my opinion, we need to talk about it more and more and more. I am in full-blown menopause, have been since 2004. Yes, I was in a state of shock when my body turned into an inferno, and I didn't understand what that meant. So I happened to have nice, older OBGYNs who called me in and set me down and explained what the change meant, because that's the vocabulary we've used, or our ancestors, or foremothers have used.
That's right.
Menopause, the word change.
The change.
That is not a good thing. We need to get rid of that word and speak about menopause. But once I learned who menopause was and how much control she had over me, I identified with my triggers, adjusted my diet, definitely had to get my rest, and I became submissive to menopause opposed to fighting it and getting all irritated. Just try to understand her and accept her. And at this day, I can say that I'm a more resolved woman, a more definite woman, a definite young lady who's convicted in who she is and her self-identification, empowered and very strong. So menopause is a welcome thing. We shouldn't be afraid of it, and we do need to study and embrace it. And if you're married or in a relationship, I highly suggest that you talk and educate your partner.
Wow, go Teresa. You're a great first guest caller. You know, that was a fabulous thing that you said. I love that you're really talking about not fighting against it. Barb Dean, that to me is a piece that you don't read a lot about what she just said. Very powerful.
Teresa, you are spot on. You are right on, because there's no one right or wrong way to approach this transition. And I love what you said, that you embraced it, you became empowered. And I'd be interested to know, you know, were there things that you did? Did you exercise more so that, and you changed your diet? It sounds like you really did a holistic approach to your whole health.
Well, my OBGYN, when she called me in for the appointment, and let's talk about the change, the first thing that came out of her mouth, because I am a woman of African descent, she said, "Ms. Coleman, there are no drugs or anything on the market for you guys. It's not going to cause cancer." Well, she ruled out worldly, Eurocentric drugs. Done. So at that point, it became nature. And I'm a Virgo, so, you know, I'm cool with my nature. I really poured myself into the nature. And I don't do anything special. I do light exercises, nothing rigorous. I take slow walks, you know, because menopause, it makes you kind of stop and slow down and reevaluate. So go take a walk.
Right, right.
So just get out there where there's rain, sleet, sun, and snow, and just because menopause is nature.
That's right. And breathing, you know, slowing down and breathing and feeling what you're feeling. You know, Teresa, thank you so much. I'm going to ask Dr. Amy Day now. I want to address something you brought up, and I appreciate you calling. That was fabulous. I hope you'll call in frequently. Dr. Amy, she brought up the issue of, you know, her OBGYN said, you know, in part because of who you are and your history, there are no medicines that we're going to use. And I know that's one of the bigger controversial areas around menopause, is whether, you know, when I was going through it, it was the hormone replacement therapy, and there weren't that many choices, but there were some. What do you tell your patients now about whether any kind of replacement is right for them?
That is a great question, Rona. It's a big question. And what I'll say that I start with is that it's really important to build a foundation. And I think of like a pyramid where the base is lifestyle, always. It comes from so much of what Teresa was talking about. There's four areas of lifestyle that I address: nutrition, fitness, sleep, and stress management. Those four are critical base regardless of what else you do. And in many cases, getting those in balance can really ease the symptoms and help people feel a lot better. Stepping up from there, we actually have quite a bit of research and quite a few options in the world of herbal medicine to help with a lot of the mood symptoms, as well as hot flashes and the period irregularities. We have a lot of options in the world of herbal or botanical medicines, and certain nutritional supplements that can help as well. And as we move up the pyramid, then, if you need to go a further rung up, there is the option of bioidentical hormones. And I know it's, you know, the whole topic of hormones is a huge conversation, but I do believe that when individualized and when taken in low doses and in the most bioidentical form available, and when well balanced with each other, that bioidentical hormone therapy can be done safely. But there's a lot to individualize and discuss with each woman.
Yeah. Well, thank you. And I'm going to let Barb Dean kind of just come right in here on this. Barb, first of all, what Dr. Amy said is bioidentical hormones, and I think it's important for people who don't know what that means, if you can explain that, and I'll have Barb do that. And also, do your patients often come to you wanting to go right to the hormone replacement therapy?
Well, I think there's lots of different women out there, and one size never fits all. So I love what Amy's talking about, is starting with lots of options that are lifestyle induced. And that's always the best way to approach things, I think, getting everything in balance. And then when it comes to bioidentical hormones, there's been so much controversy about what does that mean. Well, basically, it means that the hormone is identical to the one that your body makes. So when you're having periods every month, your body makes estrogen and progesterone. And so there are now available bioidentical hormones, same molecule that your body's used to. And they're available as FDA-approved formulations. And you can get them as oral tablets. You can get them as patches, sprays. You can get them at a compounding pharmacy. So there's lots of options for women who are looking for a bioidentical preparation. And the reason that all of us are looking for that, both those of us who practice naturopathic medicine and more Western traditional medicine, is that it seems that the research looks at lower risk. And that's what we're all trying to do, is give women safe options with lower risks.
Right. And I think, you know, again, the research is important because there had been studies showing that, you know, there was risk for both breast cancer and also heart disease for women who were taking some of the more traditional hormone replacement therapies. And so things have shifted. And yet it's still, like you said, such an individual thing. I think we'll take some more calls. 800-958-9008. We have a call from Carol now. Hi, Carol.
Hi, how are you?
Good, thank you. What's your question or advice on this?
I actually have two questions. I was one of those women who received hormone replacement back in the 80s, and I'm one of the people who got cancer and survived.
I'm glad to hear that, Carol.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it was actually due to hormone replacement. They used Premarin, an artificial hormone, and I can't remember the name of the progesterone. But the doctor did not give me the he didn't add the progesterone until the estrogen level was very high, and it still did not take care of the major problem, which was my hot flashes, which I've had for 29 years. And my two daughters, needless to say, aren't happy about that genetic relationship right now. They're miserable. They're just miserable.
Because they're worried about whether they'll have the same kind of what kind of cancer was it, if you feel comfortable saying?
Endometrial cancer.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And the doctor, you know, the cancer doctor told me it was directly because of proper dosage.
Yeah, and so, of course, without taking the hormone, there may be a very different outcome, you know, for your daughters. Is there a particular question you'd like me to ask?
Well, no. Now my daughters are experiencing the same kind of hot flashes for the last 5-6 years. And they're not looking forward to another 15 or 20, and I don't blame them. And one of them was, her doctor wants her to transfer from, she's taking birth to control. She's 53. She is going to wants to take her off the birth control pills, a low dose, to just replacement hormone, you know, do it differently. And the only difference my daughter could see was that it was going to be, instead of one pill, two pills. But the dosage was 67 times much progesterone and 3.5 times estrogen. Why would the doctor do that?
Okay, well, and so I'll ask my guests, and of course, you know, we don't give real specific medical advice. I just need to say it, you know, because it's these things are complicated. But let me see if there's any sense of what they've experienced. Dr. Day, any response here to Carol?
Well, I would say that it's definitely a known thing that unopposed estrogen is a risk for the endometrium, for the endometrial cancer. And I'm sorry to hear that happened to you, Carol, but I'm really glad that you have survived and that you're moving forward. But that unopposed estrogen, it's just one of the things that speaks to why it's so important to have the hormones balanced with each other. And definitely looking at those ratios of the estrogen and progesterone is an important thing to do. I don't know, you know, the details, of course, of your daughter's case, of which birth control pill or what kind of hormone replacement she's looking at doing now. I do think there's probably a safe way to do that for her, but it's, I don't have a specific comment on the numbers or the ratios, but just the idea that the estrogen and progesterone do indeed need to be balanced with each other mindfully, as well as some other hormones, and sometimes approaching things from adrenals or thyroid or DHEA or testosterone or other hormones that can play in. It's really important to not just do one hormone too much, like what had happened to you, Carol.
Yeah. You know why women, you know, when they become menopausal, why do women have to switch over from the birth control pills?
That's a great question. Let me ask Barb Dean here.
You know, Carol, you bring up such a great point, and I want to echo what everyone has said. Thank goodness you've recovered and that you're willing to share this, because I think it'll help a lot of women. And one of the misconceptions is that when you look at the milligrams on the birth control tablets and when you look at the dosing on the hormones that may be offered, they're not equivalent. They're not equivalent. So it may look like it's three or four times as much. It's actually about a tenth lower. So the hormones that are offered to women at menopause are about a tenth. They're a small fraction of what women are offered with the birth control pill. So, and the reason we do that is because it's safer. So it decreases the risk of blood clots. And I echo what Dr. Amy says. We have to balance estrogen and progestins. And what was available to you is not what's available to your daughters. So I would invite them to really look at this, because they may not have to suffer. And also, uterine cancer is not genetically transferred that we know of at this point. So that's not something that they're at higher risk for.
Good. Thank you. And thank you for your call, Carol.
All right. Thank you.
Really important. I appreciate it. We're talking about menopause, and, you know, we're talking to women, but I also want to invite any men to call in if you have questions about the woman in your life and how they're doing. And, you know, some people think there is a male menopause, and mostly there are changes. I want to say this. There are changes that men go through, and we see a lot of ads on TV about, you know, low T, and you know, so there are hormonal changes, but we, most professionals don't call it male menopause. But men, you know, there are things going on for you as well. So you can call us at 848-4425. Let's take a call now from Beth in Oakland.
Hi, Rona. It's Beth.
Hi, Beth. I recognize your voice. Hi.
Yes.
I know you.
Hi. Hi, hon. I was so excited when I got this email because about this topic, because there's so little being discussed around this that
yes.
One of my big issues is why there's so much shame around this topic and why women don't discuss it. I mean, young women talk about their periods, they talk about pregnancy, endlessly. I remember, you know, excuse me, as a teenager, you know, just period stuff was a common theme. But for women in their 50s, even their 40s, it only comes up in passing sometimes, or if you have to directly ask a friend about it. And then there's like this kind of uncomfortable feeling sometimes around the discussion.
That's really interesting that you say that. And, you know, people laugh and say, oh, she has hot flashes, or she's, you know, look at her, she's sweating there, you know. But you're right. What do you think it is, Beth?
You know, I think there's some shame around it. I think there's some discomfort with aging and what it means to be not fertile anymore, what it means to be in this phase of your life. And
right.
Because, like, for example, getting very hot can create issues with your partner. I've talked to a number of women where, you know, when you bring it up, they're like, oh, yeah, you know, right. My husband really had a hard time with the fact that I didn't want to sleep close to him anymore because I was so hot all the time. When I was younger, I was always cold, and I loved snuggling. And now as I get older, I'm constantly hot, and I can't spoon anymore. You know?
Right, and, you know, what's important that you're bringing up is that when we don't talk about something, when there's shame. Of course, there's not knowledge in the same way. So when women have vaginal dryness or they have a decrease in feelings of sexuality and they're not talking about it as it relates to menopause, then the shame gets worse and the solutions don't happen. Dr. Day, do you see people hesitate to talk about menopause with either you or with their friends?
I do. You know, I have to give credit to the generation before and this generation. I think we've made a lot of progress, honestly. You think, you know, you go back a ways and it was way worse than it is now. You know, we have Menopause the Musical now, and there are more outlets and more information. We have this on the radio. It's, you know, but we need more of it. It's like just scratching the surface. And I think that there is a, you know, women's health issues in general, and we are making progress. But there is something about menopause in particular that a lot of women are very uncomfortable with. And I think, Beth, you hit the nail on the head with your comments. And, you know, one of the missions that I'm on is raising more awareness about perimenopause, because I think to a certain extent, once women have really stopped their periods or when they're in the full throes of the hot flashes, there's enough information out there that they'll be like, oh, this is menopause, and they'll get that, and they realize that they can talk to their doctor about it. But the perimenopausal symptoms, when things are still you know, still kind of in that gray zone, I think that's a time especially that is like the next wave of where we need to have more discussion and more willingness to talk about it. But it is, the tie up with the declining fertility is very difficult, and discomfort with aging is really, really key. And that sexuality is always a difficult topic in our society.
Yeah, Barb.
I was going to say, I had two different approaches from two different doctors on this even. Like, one doctor was like, we'll book a 15-minute appointment, and we'll talk about hormone replacement therapy, and I can prescribe you something. Literally.
And don't ask me anything else.
Right, and that's it. And the second one was, let's book an hour and 15-minute appointment, and we're going to talk about all aspects of your life. And
wow.
I walked out of that appointment with, she's like, you know, it's not HRT. I'd like you to do this, this, and this. And she had other recommendations, including lubricants and all other stuff, you know, which had nothing to do with replacement therapy. But she really delved into sort of all areas. And, you know, it was a really different, refreshing approach to menopause counseling.
Yes. Thank you for that, Beth. It's a great point. And, you know, when I thought about doing shows, one of the callers had called in when we did a show on sleep, and she asked a question about menopause. And that's why today's show is here, because she asked a question. I thought, you know, we need a whole show on that. No one's talking about it. So thanks so much for your call. Yeah.
Thank you.
Barb Dean, I would imagine that, again, when people come in, especially in their 40s, part of the issue is they're not ready to see themselves as someone going through menopause, because, you know, back in the day, 50 sounded pretty old. And even though now women in their 50s and 60s and 70s and 80s are living great full lives, it still is something about, oh, I don't want people to see me as old.
Exactly. I always say the greatest invention was hair dye, because so many of us now, you know, who would be gray and kind of look like our grandmothers. Yeah, I know. But you look awesome. Those great eyes. You have those hot, sexy eyes, Rona. I'm not hitting on you. But, you know, one of the reasons I wrote my book is because Beth's experience with the second healthcare provider is not normal. And I was getting inundated with women wanting that individualized 1 to 2 hour visit so we could go through every aspect of their life. And I'll tell you one big issue, and that is unresolved anger with a partner. You know, so much of sex is communication, and so many times it's easier to have sex than to talk about sex at any age. And so one of the issues that comes up repeatedly with my patients is working on intimacy, emotional intimacy, not just the mechanics. Yeah, absolutely, lubricants are important, and using a little estrogen in the vagina if that's appropriate. But communication is key, and I love what you said. It's about humor. Because if you can laugh and go, I'm so freaking hot for you, baby, let's get in the shower together, that is really awesome, because then you embrace it and you say, look, things are changing for both of us. And let's not forget, ladies, 1/3 of men over 50 cannot get it up or keep it up. So we're all in the same boat.
And on that note, I think what you just said, the communication piece, is about what do I need to feel comfortable? What do I need to feel intimate? And, you know, whether, again, it's about cooling off, about time. And I think for everyone not to feel like there's something shameful or that they're failures, really, really important. Let's take another call. We have Kim with us from Vallejo. Hi, Kim.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing great. You have a question or some ideas of how you've dealt with this?
Well, I'm in full-blown menopause since 2008, and I'm perfectly comfortable with where I am in this stage of my life. My question is about comorbidity and the difficulty of having a difficult time trying to lose weight. I'm, of course, diagnosed with morbid obesity. I also have a low thyroid problem called Hashimoto's disease, and I'm also a type 2 diabetic. And so I just wanted maybe some suggestions about losing weight. I've talked to a nutritionist and my doctor, and I walk every day, and I'm just not moving anywhere.
You know, I'm so appreciative of you calling, and I could hear that this is a real struggle, but the things you mentioned, you know, Hashimoto's, which is a thyroid disease, diabetes, and menopause, there's a lot of relationships here, and I'll let Dr. Amy Day address that first.
Sure, yeah, a lot of connection. You know, we very rarely have one thing to deal with at a time. So having, you know, your list, but they all interact with each other. And one of the approaches in naturopathic medicine is to look at what commonalities are underlying the things that are presenting and going on, to see how things are connected. And looking at how the weight and the thyroid and the diabetes and the insulin function and the hormones and the menopause and all of that interact with each other is a really important part of untangling that web. And knowing that it doesn't have to be about perfectly addressing every single one of those, but finding the steps that you can take that help all of those at the same time. So it sounds like you're doing some of the right things already, and I just really encourage you to continue with looking at how to refine your lifestyle and the support that you can get from your other practitioners.
I also, Dr. Day, the Hashimoto's, I think, you know, thyroid disease, I know when I had Graves' disease, and that's another autoimmune disease, and it there's so much that happens when you have an autoimmune disease and you have thyroid disease, where often I would be out of balance with my thyroid hormones, and I felt like sometimes doctors paid attention to that and sometimes they didn't, and sometimes better tests were needed. And I think the key that I would also say to Kim is how important it is to make sure that the thyroid testing is done regularly, and that she really keep learning about what those symptoms would be if it's out of whack, because that's going to affect the diabetes, it's going to affect her weight and mood and everything else. So Barb, you probably deal a lot with people who come to see you with weight issues and thyroid issues at the same time, yeah?
Absolutely, and I like what Kim and you are talking about, and that is, you know, we're looking at values for thyroid testing now. We're re-looking at those values, and I think it's good to keep a record, Kim, of all of your numbers and how you feel. Keeping a journal is really important because you can find what your sweet spot is. And Dr. Day, I know you do a lot of individualized therapy, and so do I. And what we want to do is find your sweet spot, Kim. And also keeping a food diary and making sure that you listen to your nutritionist, but I encourage my diabetic patients to test their blood sugar more often, not less. Find what your levels are based on what you're eating. You may have to titrate a little bit. You may have to spend a little bit more time with one of your providers and say, you know, I know you're telling everybody else at my height to have this many grams of carbs, but I do better on less, or I do better on more. Really think about checking your own blood sugar more often. So find your individual sweet spot and become even more empowered. And I love the path that you're on. I love hearing that you're exercising. And I just want to tell you, keep up the good work, Kim.
Yeah. Well, my blood sugars have been fine, and my A1C was good, and all my thyroids are excellent.
Good.
I just can't seem to lose any weight.
You know, I want to say to everyone, including myself, who sometimes struggle with weight, it's a big issue, and it's no one's fault, you know, that I really believe that this is a societal issue. I'm reading some books now on the gut and how what we eat based on whether we're eating probiotics and prebiotics. And, you know, there are so many factors that affect weight. So reduce and get rid of any blame and shame. Keep reaching out to the people who are working with you. And every time you take a walk, that matters. And, you know, there are programs out there, and I'm so glad you called. And with menopause, it's just sort of one more thing that says you got to pay attention to me, old body here, and try and do things that I need. So thank you, Kim, so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. We're talking about menopause, and we're talking about, you know, when it starts. And again, a lot of people don't realize that perimenopause often starts in a person's 40s, and there are sort of signs that you think, oh, I don't know what this is. And you know, people don't talk enough about it to figure out that this may be the beginning of those hormonal changes. I had a question from someone, maybe I can ask you, Dr. Day. She asked about, she's right over the first year of menopause, and she's having some knee problems. And she wondered about the connection between menopause and osteoarthritis.
Sure, yeah. That joint aches is one of the symptoms. It can definitely be one of the symptoms of menopause. It's one that is not as often talked about. So it's one that women are often surprised to hear that, oh, my knee pain or my aching fingers or my shoulder that's been hurting or whatever, oh, that could be related to menopause. So it really can be. There are definitely changes that are happening that lead to more inflammation and more discomfort in the joints. To tie back to thyroid. Thyroid is another cause of aches and pains sometimes. And the idea of, I really appreciate what you said, Barb, about retesting the thyroid, because as you go through menopause, your other hormones can change. So the same dose or the same, you know, way of helping your thyroid that you used to do, you might need to do something different now. So that would be a piece that I think would be important to look at when aches and pains and joint problems are part of what's happening in menopause, is looking at the hormones, looking at thyroid, and just recognizing that as we age, we do tend more and more to inflammation, and that a lot of our degenerative diseases are related to inflammation, and how important it is to look at how to produce an anti-inflammatory environment in our body. And you know, that can be things like fish oil is a great natural anti-inflammatory with so many health benefits. Turmeric as an herb is another one that is very well researched and really effective. And looking at your diet, and you mentioned gut health a minute ago, Rona, so important for hormone balance. We don't necessarily think of our gut and digestive system as having a lot to do with that, but it really does. So seeing how all these pieces connect, and inflammation is often a common piece that is really helpful to address with an anti-inflammatory approach.
Thanks, Amy. And I remember, too, suddenly asking my doctor to test me for my vitamin D levels, and those had gone rock bottom right around, I think, the time after menopause. And so I know when your vitamin D levels are very low, you can get a lot of aches and pains as well, and it affects your bones tremendously. So I just want to remember to say, if you haven't had a vitamin D level checked, the doctors are doing that more often now. Barb, do you do that routinely?
Routinely. Because so many of us use sunscreen, and vitamin D is really important for mood as well. And just tagging on to what Dr. Amy says, you know, we lose collagen when we lose estrogen. As our estrogen levels drop, our collagen levels drop. That's why we get more wrinkles. But collagen is, you know, one of the things that keeps our joints and our muscles healthy. So it's not surprising.
That's very interesting. Well, we're talking about menopause. You can ask a question that you've been wanting to ask, 510-848-4425. We have Nurse Barb Dean here. She's a nurse practitioner, and we have Dr. Amy Day, who's a naturopath. Barb, you said there were three basic things. You talked about sleep, weight, and sex. Which one of those do you want to address? They're all important.
Well, you know, everybody wants to talk about sex, but let me start with sleep.
Yeah.
As estrogen levels drop, one other thing that drops is serotonin. And so our serotonin levels drop, but our serotonin receptors in our hypothalamus and our brain, those actually increase. So just at the time when we have more serotonin receptors, we're thirsty for it. And serotonin helps us stay happy and it helps us stay balanced, but it also helps us sleep. So a lot of women have sleep disturbances in menopause, and sometimes it can be related to low serotonin levels. It can be related to lots of other things like an underlying anxiety. And so one thing that I work with my patients on is doing mindful meditation and doing mindfulness to help them. It's a very natural, cheap, it's inexpensive way to help you sleep. And if you're not really into the mindfulness and you haven't discovered John Kabat-Zinn's work, you can download guided imagery and guided meditation to help you sleep at night.
You know, and serotonin is so important. So besides meditation and mindfulness and chocolate, what else helps to raise that for women?
Well, some women do really well with melatonin. Some women do well with certain herbs. Some women do well with soy. Some women Dr. Amy was saying, some women metabolize soy into its natural metabolite. Some women don't. There are SSRIs. These are selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors that some of us prescribe for women during menopause. And it's not an antidepressant. We don't prescribe it as an antidepressant. We prescribe it to help them with their serotonin levels so that they can have fewer hot flashes and night sweats, but it also helps them sleep at night. And with one of these medications, there's no risk of breast cancer. There's no risk of blood clots or cardiovascular disease. So that's something that a lot of my patients are saying, well, you know, I really don't want to use hormones, but what else do you have to offer me?
Uh-huh. Good. What about other things that you suggest, Amy, about sleep?
Yeah, so to tie in with part of what Barb was just talking about, supporting that serotonin and that calm, happy feeling is really, really important. An area that I do quite a bit of work with is with adrenal health and balance, and I think that ties in with sleep a lot. A lot of women, so just to explain, the adrenals are our main stress organs, and they produce a hormone called cortisol. They produce a variety of other hormones as well, but cortisol is our primary stress hormone. And when we live our days in a constant state of stress, from one deadline to the next emergency to the next deadline, that we're running on high cortisol a lot, and that can be really depleting to the adrenal system. And over time, it is hard for that whole control mechanism to work properly. And a lot of women that have been living a very go-go-go kind of life end up feeling very depleted and down and low. That can be low mood, low energy. But then what happens, the pattern for a lot of women is that we'll feel that way during the day, and then come 7 p.m., 8 p.m., maybe even 9 or 10 p.m. if you're up that late, you get a second wind. And all of a sudden, bing, everything like clears up and your focus is on and your energy is up, and it's really hard to wind down and go to sleep at that time. So I love the recommendation of a mindfulness meditations, just really thinking mm-hmm. about working with your natural rhythms for adrenals and being able to wind yourself down at nighttime and get up and get going in the morning to help reset a more natural rhythm where you have energy in the day and then go down at night is a really important aspect of helping support a healthy sleep cycle.
And I just want to say at nurserona.com, I did post the link. Dr. Day has a adrenal guide that you can download for free, talking more about this. So I really appreciate that, Amy Day. And I think we'll take some more calls. We have a call now from Carla. Hi, Carla.
Hi. thanks for this show. It's really great. And I wanted to plug the Northern California's Women's Herbal Symposium, which offers a 5-day retreat. The next one coming up is in September, but it's a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. It's only women up in Northern Sonoma County. And I wanted to address the honoring of women in menopause. All women are there, and the older women hang out with the younger teenage girls, and there's an honoring of every aspect from the young to the old of the women, and it's really beautiful.
That is really lovely, and I'm so glad you said that, because it is that intergenerational honoring that we all need to bring more into our life. I was just thinking that my daughter does new moon circles, and it's intergenerational, and I learn so much from the younger folks, and I think they learn a few things from me. And the idea that this herbal symposium, you know, is a place of honoring women is terrific. How do people find out about that?
Well, there is a website, Northern California Women's Herbal Symposium. You know, the main way.
Good.
I'm not seeing.
That's perfect. Everyone knows how to Google it.
Right. Everybody knows how to Google it, and it's wonderful. You know, the young girls who are just starting their moon time have a whole ceremony that's done by the menopausal women and actually the crones. We have all of this beautiful sharing that goes on there in many, many ways.
It's a wonderful resource.
Especially anybody with young girls should come with their daughters to this. It's incredible.
Well, thank you. I appreciate you listening and you calling. And that's the Northern Sonoma.
Northern California Women's Herbal
Symposium in September. Yeah. Beautiful.
It happens actually, three times a year now, I think.
I'm going to look it up myself.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for your show.
Oh, thank you, Carla. Good. We have our first guy on the phone. Let's talk with Marvin from Vallejo. Hi.
Hello.
Hi.
Thanks for letting me call.
Show.
I want to make a contribution. The idea of meditation. Now, the pineal gland coincides with the third eye, and that is important with serotonin and melatonin. And maybe you can talk about that. Overtone singing stimulates the pineal gland. The other thing I wanted to mention is that holy basil or tulsi is anti-inflammatory and anti-aging because of that, and it's antioxidant. So holy basil is easy to grow, and that's what I wanted to give you.
Well, thank you for that. I love holy basil and tulsi. And let me ask Dr. Day about the pineal gland, the third eye, the sixth chakra. Anything you want to add about that?
Sure. The pineal gland is located there. For anyone who's not familiar with those terms that you just said, it's kind of in the back, like behind the forehead, like between the eyes, but a little higher than that. And in the back, and that is where the pineal gland lives. And the pineal gland is what produces the melatonin. So the serotonin that Barb was talking about earlier is a precursor to making melatonin. And then that melatonin is produced from the pineal gland. And melatonin is what gives the signal to the body that it is time to sleep. So we really do want to support that. And one thing I'll add, I love the other comments that Marvin made, holy basil also, and for supporting the pineal gland and the production of melatonin, darkness at nighttime is very important. The pineal gland is stimulated by light to tell it to stop producing melatonin, so that happens in the morning, but at nighttime we want to produce a dark environment, so dimming the lights for the hour or two before going to bed and wearing an eye mask while you sleep, or using blackout curtains that make the room really dark. Those can make a really big difference. One of the classic behaviors that I see in my patient population is being on the computer or the phone or the iPad or something prior to going to bed at night. And that light stimulation absolutely interferes with our biochemical ability to shut everything down and get a really good restorative night's sleep. So one of the recommendations I make for my patients is no screens for an hour before bedtime. I'd love it to be longer than that even, but just to try to be realistic, no screens, no input, trying to just have it be dark and calm and quiet, doing a meditation or some foam rolling or some yoga or taking a hot bath, something to really help teach the body to wind down at nighttime. And then in the morning, have exposure to sunlight. Get outside first thing in the morning, even if it's just for, a couple minutes to do a couple quick stretches. Our ideal would be to go for a walk first thing in the morning, get fresh air and fresh sunlight to help stimulate the body into its natural rhythm.
Really good advice. And parents, those of you who have teenagers as well, have a docking station in the kitchen and get those phones out of your children's rooms. They say they needed to wake up in the morning, buy them an alarm. That light is not good for them. The stimulation isn't good for them. They need their sleep. You need your sleep. Barbara Dean, we actually have about 5 minutes left. We have to end a little early today. So maybe we should say a few more things about sex before we end. We got to,
let's talk about some things you can do in your room besides sleep or other rooms of wherever you dwell. Here's what I say. It's very normal and natural for women to need more lubrication as they get older. So there's no shame in that. And there's lots of great lubricants out there.
I just found one the other day that I was looking up for the show. I was looking up different things, and there was one called Aloe Cadabra.
Yes, that's a good one.
Yeah.
I'm going to put in a plug. I don't receive any money from this, but there's a great website called Middlesex MD, and it's run by a friend of mine, Dr. Barb Dupree. I don't receive anything from her. I just want you to know it's a really nice place where you can get anything you need from the privacy of your own home. But I'm Italian. Great lubricant is olive oil. You can use coconut oil. Anything you cook with that you put in your mouth, you can also put in other parts of your body.
Coconut oil, yeah.
Don't you love coconut oil? And then you want to go to Hawaii, olive oil. You want a salad. Hello. The thing about sex at this time is that it can be really fun to take more time. And sex is not just about penis and the vagina. Penis and the vagina. Sex is so much more than that. So make sure you spend some time exploring your body and your partner's body and find other fun, creative ways to have a good time.
And what you said before was the part about talking, to definitely be talking about it. So weight loss, we don't have time to go into more, but there's a lot out there. It is something that happens with menopause. And, for some people, they're trying to get a handle on that in their 40s by making sure they're keeping up their exercise. Barb Dean, you can go to her website, barbdean.com.
Nursebarb.com.
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 And Amy Day, DrAmyDay.com. Thank you both so much for being on this show with us. I really appreciate it. And I'll be back, I guess, in a couple of weeks. In the meantime, you can reach me at my website at nurserona.com. My gratitude to our board operator, Kevin Vance, and our producer, Felix Lee. The KPFA local station board elections are coming up this fall. Up next is a short Q&A from the Pacifica National Election Supervisor on how to apply to become a candidate for KPFA's local station board. All of you have a great day.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Ciao.
Greetings to all of you listening on the Pacifica Airways. This is your National Election Supervisor, Eljoy Williams, with some important information about the 2015 local station board election process. Your participation as a candidate, a voter, or by helping with outreach efforts is crucial to the success of your station. A lot of you have questions about this process, and here with a few questions is frequent listener Kim. Thanks for your help, Kim.
No problem, Joy.
So what can you tell us about this election?
Sure. This is an election for the local station board. This station is part of Pacifica Radio, America's oldest independent media network and the only radio network with a democratically elected board. The local station board has a lot of power. The board members oversee programming, approve the station's budget, and create policy to ensure that programs represent the needs of listeners and the communities served by the station.
Wow. That is a lot of responsibility. As a listener, can I be involved in this process? How?
Sure, you can. You can participate in the process in a number of ways. First, by being a member of your local station, by running as a candidate, or helping to spread the word about the election.
Well, I listen to Pacifica every day. Does that make me a member?
Being a regular listener is great, but to really support the station and participate in the election process, you must become a member by making a minimum annual donation of $25 or perform 3 hours of volunteer work at the station before midnight, Tuesday, July 14th.
So my next question is, let's say I want to do more than vote. I want to actually become a candidate. What are the requirements to run as a candidate?
Well, just like a voter, you will also need to be a current member of the station by Tuesday, July 14th. And you also need to complete the candidate nomination package. You can find that on the website at elections.pacifica.org. You can also get a hard copy from your local election supervisor.
What's in the nomination package? What materials do I have to submit, and when is it due?
That's a lot of questions in one, but I can answer them. You have to submit a written candidate statement, 15 petition signatures from other members of the station, and sign the fair campaign pledge that you will follow the rules of the election process. All of this must be submitted before 10 p.m. on Tuesday, July 14th, in order to qualify as a candidate.
Wait, 15 signatures from members? I have about 100 Facebook friends, but I don't know if they're all members of a station. How can I get support from 15 other members?
Well, you can ask your Facebook friends if they're members of the station for one, but your local election supervisor will also host a signing party at the station so other members can support you and sign your petition.
Oh, okay. Then I'm going to get my candidate statement together right away. I can submit that online too, right?
You sure can. You can find all of the information you need about the election on the website at elections.pacifica.org. And when you submit your statement, it will be posted right on the website.
Okay, so after I renew my membership by donating at least $25 to the station, submit my materials to become a candidate before Tuesday, July 14th, what happens next?
Well, providing that all of your submitted materials are in and your candidacy is verified, what's next is the campaign.
I've never been a candidate before or campaigned before. What do I do and where do I campaign?
It's okay. Your local election supervisor will help you through the process. The local election supervisor will host several on-air and in-person opportunities to make your opinions known to the voting public and to debate with other candidates during the election period.
This is so exciting. This is so great that listeners like me get to participate in the process. Thanks for all this information, Joy. I'm going to get started getting my materials together right now.
That's so great, Kim. And to those of you listening, you can get involved in this process too. Remember, you must renew or become a member of your station by midnight on Tuesday, July 14th to vote in this election. And to be a candidate, you must be a member and submit the materials in the candidate nomination package by 10 p.m. on Tuesday, July 14th. Please visit the elections website at elections.pacifica.org for up-to-date information, to see a list of candidates running at your station, and for contact information for your local election supervisor.
Be sure to catch Apex Express on KPFA. Apex Express is a weekly program following news and cultural events throughout Asia and the Pacific Islands. Find out about issues affecting Asian American and Pacific Islander communities locally and globally. Get on board the Apex Express Thursday evenings at 7 p.m. on KPFA.
Here's another community-powered announcement from KPFA. The Laurel District Association is honored to invite you to the 16th annual Laurel Street Fair being held on Saturday, August 8th in the city of Oakland on MacArthur Boulevard between 35th and 38th Avenue.
The Laurel Street Fair is committed to keeping our festival admissions free, wheelchair accessible, and open to all.
We'll be welcoming a stellar lineup of local musicians, artists, poets, and DJs for a day of fun featuring special guests,
Sila,
Roomba Shea,
MJ Brass Boppers,
Oakland Future Trio,
and Samba Shea.
Also DJs Emancipation, Roots of Rhythm, and DJ Zeta. MCs Preston Turner, Gina Madrid, and more.
All proceeds benefit the Laurel District Association.
To sign up to be a volunteer, to donate, or learn more, please visit us at laurelstreetfair.com.
See you soon.
A Rude Awakening with Sabrina coming up in a half an hour at 3:30 this afternoon here on KPFA. At 4 o'clock, it's Hard Knock Radio, and at 5 o'clock, it's Flashpoints. 6 o'clock brings you the KPFA Evening News. These are your listener-sponsored stations for Northern and Central California and the world. KPFA in Berkeley at 94.1, KPFB in Berkeley at 89.3, and KFCF in Fresno at 88.1. Online, around the world, all the time, at kpfa.org. Arts Waves on Cover to Cover is next. The time is 3 o'clock.